Hello and welcome to the post-mortem video for Compulsion Rush. I'm Scott Glendinning, the lead designer for the project, and here with me is Corey Tilley, the tech lead.
Hello.
John Schwander, the audio engineer.
Yo.
Stephen Lindsay, our art lead.
How's it going?
And Chris Metcalf, our QA lead.
Hello.
Okay, to give a brief overview of the video game, Compulsion Rush, it's a fast-paced racing game that mixes in some Twitch-based first-person shooter aspects via the tether nodes that we sort of developed. And with them, the player can attach to them and go around corners faster and speed their vehicle up, jump over obstacles. Any sort of different mixture of actions can be taken with them, but at the beginning, we sort of stripped it all down to its basic parts, and then with each iteration, we looked at it again and saw how much time we had and added more stuff in. Stuff that sets our game sort of apart, things that we really want to highlight are the tether node. It can be used in huge number of ways. It actually caused some emergent gameplay that was pointed out to us from some of our testers that we had, but anyway, let's open it up to the team, and they can talk about it and take it from there.
As far as the tether goes, I mean, you know, we really wanted to make sure that it reacted well to each of the vehicles. So we started out with kind of a prototype vehicle model, and each one needed its own iteration to feel right with the tether.
Another big part of the tether is definitely, as Scott mentioned before, is that emergent gameplay. When we had the tether set up, it was pretty obvious to us that was going to be one of the most empowering things a player could do. You ever give them a sense of being awesome when they're racing on a track, especially with the track designs and having gaps and jumps that the player can manipulate with by using the tethers and just really drive that home.
Truthfully, I think one of our hardest things throughout the whole project was actually getting these tether nodes to feel not exact, but to our specification and actually feeling different with each vehicle itself.
Okay, so next up we've got some vehicle models and feel. We started out with a really basic model that was something to just throw in the game and start our early prototypes off with. We ended up bringing in some models that we made custom in 3D Studio Max. And that presented us with sort of a new problem because that brought in different physics. The vehicles reacted a little bit differently than what we were expecting, so we had to adjust those accordingly.
And especially the way the tether would pull. I mean, one of the things we wanted to focus on with the tether was the slingshot of the corners. And it was really difficult to get each vehicle dialed in.
They each had their own stats and sort of like roles to play, and we emulated that with our RPM curve in the script with how the engine should sound, sort of like shifting in a race car or anything like that.
Continuing with that idea, the just detailing into how much needed to be done and tweaked for each one was so drastically different just because of the difference in physics on each model itself.
Moving forward from the vehicle models, we sort of had started with some early track modeling. We had some hopes of bringing in like modular track pieces so we could sort of piece them together. But what we ended up going with was we would model out a spline in 3D Studio Max and then loft a shape along that, and that ended up working out really well.
Well, and the good thing with all those tracks is the fact that it gives each individual track its own feel with having to strategically place tether nodes to help through turns along with around obstacles themselves.
We actually did a lot in terms of menus and stuff in this game. Stuff like the audio implementation of turning things up, turning things down, controller setups and stuff like that. We did a lot with that.
Yeah, when you're talking sort of like audio sliders, if you have more than two sliders, one for music, one for sound effects, or one for anything that's repeated in another one, like we have a master, make sure your math lines up based on both sliders. That'll be a headache early on if you don't catch that, so look out for that.
Working in scale form to create the minis, it's a lot more versatile than using canvas. Canvas, you have to make very minute adjustments to where exactly you want an object to be placed on the screen. Whereas scale form, using Flash and ActionScript, you can pretty much change those in real time and drag and drop everything where you want it to be.
Now we come up to a pretty big project was the audio.
Yeah, I know John had some issues implementing the dynamic music adjustment that actually adjusted with the speed the player's traveling. And the track would kind of build up as they were going faster, and if they slowed down, the track would kind of back off a little bit.
Yeah, and a big thing about audio is when you want to do something tricky like that, it gets tricky with looping, and you're really going to want to look into audio components. If you can learn those and figure them out, they're a very powerful tool for doing something like that, or adjusting music on the fly, fading in, fading out. But you have to be careful and learn where those limits are.
When working with Corey McMaster, our music composer, and Derek Williams, the mixer, we found that when you want to introduce a better audio, you should really start the process early and keep those individuals who are making the music in the loop as early on in the project as possible to melt the flow and just create an awesome project.
All right, another big thing that we ended up adding a little bit into our project, that AI in the game.
Yeah, and really the biggest thing about getting the AI really is just getting the path nodes placed to where they can actually see the tether node and make it around the turn still, and still be a challenge to the player as well.
And since the AI was so well-developed, it was actually looking for these tether nodes and using them as a player would, which was actually complex enough that we could use it to build our intro cinematic that actually represents actual gameplay rather than just moving actors around.
Another feature that we really wanted in the game from early on was a save load system and the ability to use an actual like Xbox 360 controller. So what we ended up doing to get through this was actually being able to use config files.
Yeah, we have all kinds of stuff in the config files. I mean, we track what vehicles selected from the menu, the controller layout, the most recent mouse sensitivity that's set, whether you turn the aim assist on or off, just pretty much every option that's available in the game.
One of the issues that I ran into when working in the menus and trying to add a gamepad support is that we actually had to add a screen that the players hit start or hits enter on the keyboard to dictate whether the player's using a gamepad or a mouse and keyboard. Because if you tried using the mouse, it would actually take focus away from the controller support and not let you go back to using that.
All right, well, that pretty much wraps up the different topics we wanted to cover for our postmortem. Thank you for coming.